Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, Billy. As always, I am joined in this edition by Tier Zero, Taylor Bryden. How's it going?
Absolutely fine. Really pleased to actually get a chance to actually speak to you, Billy. Yes. I've never really done one of these before, so it's good to actually get a chance.
Yeah, I mean, well, of course, I would have seen you wrestle for a number of years now when W3L comes up this side of the country. So it's nice to actually speak to you. I don't find a lot of interviews with you, so I don't know if you just don't get asked or if you're quite private or what. But hopefully we'll be able to delve into your 16 years in pro wrestling.
Yeah, definitely.
But you're not escaping the first question. The first one's always the same. How did you get into pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
Well, I didn't actually know what wrestling was until I was maybe about 11 years old. And I'd heard people mentioning like Stone Cold Steve Austin, The Rock. And at the time, we didn't have Sky. I think that was the only way that you could watch wrestling back then. So I'd managed to get like a couple of like recorded tapes that my friends had recorded Monday Night Raw for me to watch. And like since I started watching that, I just thought it was larger than life. And I just really wanted to keep watching it. So when we got Sky, when I was maybe like 13, I just completely binged on wrestling.
Yeah, we always know one guy. We always have one friend that had like Sky Sports or something like that. Yep. And was able to get it. I've still got them, but my folks, I still got boxes of VHS tapes because my friend fell out of wrestling, but his dad always stayed up and taped it off his box office. So yeah. I've got tapes and tapes of stuff, original, unedited, not on the network anymore kind of stuff. So who's your first? So Stone Cold was the name you heard of, but was there anyone that kind of caught your eye initially?
Well, I started watching wrestling in like 1999, but I didn't seriously start watching until a little bit later. So I think probably Cactus Jack, because of the street fight with Triple H.
Yeah.
And Triple H himself and Jericho. Like, those are the sort of three people that I remember most from that era. And then slightly after that, when The Undertaker returned, I suppose The Undertaker and Kane would come into it as well.
That's my sweet spot then, 2000, 2001. I'm pretty much the same boat then. I started kind of 99, but 2000 was when I proper got into it. Channel 4 helped by having Heat and having Royal Rumble 2000, which is amazing. Just that whole street fight, probably one of my favourite matches of all time as well, just because it's just brutal.
It's a brilliant match.
So 11 years old, 1999-ish kind of time. So what made you decide to go from watching to trying to do it?
Well, I'd kind of set my mind by 2002 that I really wanted to be a wrestler. And I thought, at the time, because the internet wasn't a massive thing back in 2002. Not everybody had the internet. Nobody had access to the internet all the time. So I was kind of like looking in papers and stuff like that. And I'd seen like a training school down in Manchester. I think it was maybe FWA at the time. And I really wanted to go there, but I wasn't old enough to go down myself. So I'd kind of been in my mind since then. And I just randomly seen in the local paper to us, the 5P Press, that W3L was starting up in 2005. And funnily enough, W3L actually started up on the 13th of March 2005. That was the first training session they ran as a school. So actually, if we'd been recording this tomorrow, it would have actually been on my 16th anniversary of starting training.
Oh, wow. But we're originally supposed to speak tomorrow as well, which is
exactly
even spookier.
Yeah, so I was quite nice actually. Like, I know that the past year's not been entirely brilliant for everybody, like especially on a wrestling front. But yeah, I'm still going to count it. I'm still going to count the 16 years.
Absolutely. I mean, we will speak about your transformation over the last year as well in a bit. But we'll kind of stick to your debut. So according to the Germans at Cage Match, your debut match was against a random guy called Drew Galloway.
Yeah, it was. Mike had brought him in. It was Mike's second show that he promoted when he came back from Canada, and he just needed somebody for Drew to hammer in a squash. And because at the time I'd been training maybe four or five months at this time, so I was way too green to be even thinking about stepping in a ring. But he just needed somebody that Drew could beat up, and it was me that he put in there in that spot. I was always grateful that I got the opportunity then, but it was actually, as a 16-year-old, it was really nerve-wracking to actually be performing in the first place. And because wrestling was a much different place back then than it is now. Like, it was so, even compared to, like, in the sort of, like, 2000s, when it was, like, closely guarded, it was still fairly closely guarded. There was, what, two schools in Scotland at the time? Like, Mike's school and BCW had a school as well. I think maybe SWA, actually. So there was only the three schools in Scotland at the time. So it was one of those things that it was just so overwhelming to actually be in there. But yeah, I'm glad that I got the opportunity to do it.
And Drew's done all right for himself, I suppose. You know,
yeah, he has.
Casual WWE champion two times now. So back to the start of training then. Did you have a bit of a sports background? 16, I'm assuming you played football, things like that, or was there a bit more athletic, rugby, anything like that?
No, not at all. Like, I used to just lift weights in the gym at school. I didn't play football. I didn't actually start watching football until about 2006, maybe. So, like, no, it was 2005. It was Jose Mourinho's first season in England. And that was when I first started watching football. So I'd actually been watching wrestling longer than football at that time. So as such, having never watched football and never really played football until then, I was absolutely horrendous at it. So I just didn't play it at all. So yeah, lifting weights. And I did a little bit distance running as well at school, but nothing like on a competitive level. It was just what we did in physical education.
Mm-hmm. Hockey. Smacking each other with sticks. That's pretty much what I remember from PE. So was W3L, were they ring straight away, or was it initially mats you were on?
We were on mats for a good probably year, 2 years. We were in like a little port-a-cabin type thing, and it was just judo mats, like 12 judo mats on a floor, and we just had to wrestle on that, so we didn't learn with the ring originally. We only got that in 2006, I think, the ring came.
So, I mean, putting that in perspective in your timeline, you started training 5-6 months later, you're in a ring.
Yeah.
So, was that just the morning you got to have a wee feel of it, or was it the fact that you're just like, no, you're not getting anything in here, you're just bumping. Don't worry about it.
Well, before the show actually took place, we all got an opportunity to learn to run the ropes and things like that. But in my match, it wasn't really even a necessity. I was literally just getting my ass handed to me.
So what was your first experience with the bumping, the drills? What were your initial thoughts? Was it like, this is a bit scary?
Well, I was always really quite willing, just up for really just anything when it came to training. I was always quite a shy teenager. And had quite a lot of anxiety. Not that I knew it back then, but looking back retrospectively, I could see that that's where it was. But I'd made sort of a decision myself that when I went to wrestling training, anything that people were asking for volunteers for, I was always going to volunteer for it because I wanted to do it. And I think to put it in perspective, the first day that Mike opened his school, we had, I think there was like between 25 and 30 guys that turned up to that session. By the next week, there was maybe 12, and by the week after that, there was 6 of us, and that was it that was left. It was just too hard. People didn't like bumping on the mats. People didn't like that there was no ring. I think that was the big appeal for a lot of people. A lot of people thought there was going to be a ring there, and there wasn't. It was just mats to learn. So I think it was just so hard because the floor had no give at all. You were on a floor that had a big wooden beam underneath it, so there was no bounce, no nothing. It was just mats.
Do you remember anyone else? Is anyone in that last 6 still around, or is it just yourself now?
No, just me. Like from the first session, it's only me that's left. Everybody else has fell away by the wayside. Like a lot of them they did wrestle on after that. Like, I think there was a few that wrestled up until maybe about 2008, 2009. But they all left for family reasons or just didn't want to do it anymore. So, yeah, out of the original W3L guys, I'm the only person that was at that first training session that's still wrestling today.
So you can, other than Mike, of course, who ran it, you're the only one you could definitely say that you're a W3L original.
100%. But then you've got, like, maybe a few months after that, you've got Sarah Marie Taylor that joined, and then you've got Kevin Williams, he joined as well not long after that. So all of us were there within the first year at W3L being opened.
It was just because it was nearby initially, or just, because you said you're in Fife. So was that the appeal? It was near, you didn't have to travel all the way down to Manchester. And you got to at least give it a go.
Exactly, and I thought, well, I'll give it a try and I'll see how I get on. I was like, and if it's a fun hobby, then it's a fun hobby.
We discussed your first match. We'll forget that one for a moment. We don't want to say forget about it entirely because it was against Drew Galloway. But so what was your first actual match you got to do things in?
First actual match that I got to do things in?
And you did say beforehand your memory is shocking. So
yeah, it's shocking. I'm pretty sure that the sort of next, like, sort of big thing that I did was as Matsuo Kazuma. Like, because there was a little pause where I'd got injured and I was away from training for a little bit, so I couldn't do too much. And then when I came back from my injury, Mike had got another guy to do the Matsuo Kazuma gimmick. But he was struggling a little bit and needed a wee bit further training. So Mike asked if I would take it on, and just seeing it as an opportunity to get extra bookings, extra work, I just thought I would do it. And it was probably just the sort of Matsuo Kazuma stuff after that. I think me and you and G Mackey tagged for a while as, I think they were called the Cartoon Heroes. He was himself, and then I was like the mass Japanese guy. So, yeah, we did a couple of, like, tag team matches with things like that.
And, of course, you went on to tag with Ewan quite a bit as Disco Biscuits.
Yeah, that came not long after that.
So what was it like teaming with Ewan? Of course, before the world ended, you guys reunited. But what was it like initially teaming with Ewan?
It was good because at the time he was kind of floundering as to what to do in wrestling. And I was the same. Like, we were both looking for, like, our first sort of proper gimmick that we could use, that we could actually work everywhere with. And he's such a creative mind that it was good to be able to work with someone that had the same sort of work ethic and sort of understanding of wrestling as I did. So, yeah, I was brilliant. I opened a lot of doors and a lot of opportunities from there with the Disco Biscuits to actually go elsewhere, like going to SWA. To wrestle there and also work in W3L.
So you said before that you're quite shy and a bit introverted and all that kind of stuff. So did you find wrestling, it was just totally different? A lot of people say just as soon as you go out the curtain, it just clicks and that's you, you're a character. Did you find any difficulty expressing yourself in the ring?
I still do now as well. I think, you know, you see football players, it's always described that they need, like, an arm around their shoulder and they need that little bit of confidence. Like, they've got all the ability in the world, but they just need a little bit of confidence put into them. I think that I'm very much one of those people. Like, sometimes if I'm a little bit low in confidence, I could make a lot of mistakes that I wouldn't usually make. So I think the past couple of years has been trying to get my mentality better and trying to not focus too much on perfection and beating myself up over things. So with wrestling, I think that's been one of the biggest challenges for me, is trying to get over that while still performing in the ring as well.
I think if I remember rightly, I could be totally misremembering it though, but you put up a little bit in one of Looking Sharp's dojo bits, pretty much saying that you were chasing that perfection, and because of that you didn't think that you kind of talked yourself out of going other places or trying to go to other places because you didn't feel like you'd you'd were good enough kind of thing. So is that pretty much been your, like you said, that has been your last two, three years of just kind of pressing that bit?
Yeah, I think I wasn't in so many words, but yeah, it was basically just, you often hear about people saying that they sleep on people, like people don't know about people or people don't give people a chance. Sometimes you don't give yourself a chance because you're too busy getting caught up thinking that you're not good enough to try to go elsewhere, or that you convince yourself that it's just a hobby, so you don't need to, you just need to be comfortable where you are. But in reality, like, I really wanted to do a lot more, and I was just trying to, you just put up like all these blocks, trying to stop yourself doing something or making excuses to do something, and I wanted to stop that. And that's not just like in a wrestling thing, that's just like in, just in general, like, I'm terrible for doing it, and it's just something that I've been trying to work through myself, just to not be so hard on myself, to actually think that I might be good enough to actually do something else in wrestling other than what I'm doing. I was just saying, just learn to try and take a chance on myself for a change.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm absolutely in with that. I mean, not so much in the actual wrestling bit, because I'm not a wrestler, but since starting this podcast, I was in that kind of boat where I go, oh, I'm not going to get so-and-so because they're too big of a name. They're too high profile. They're going to speak to me. And the last couple of weeks, it has been a case of, right, I'll try. I mean, I've had none of them reply to me, but it's the trying, I suppose, is the important bit in all of this. But yeah, it's just getting that confidence and, yeah, believing in yourself. Were you a big belt guy growing up? Did you like to, because I know you got your first title, I've got here 2009 with the Disco yes. Biscuits tag team title.
Yes.
Was that a big moment for you?
Yeah, definitely. Anytime that any promoter wants to like put some trust in you to actually be the forefront of any division they've got, is always something that's brilliant. It's a good feeling to actually have that sort of trust put into you. But I wouldn't say that I'm a massive belt guy. Like, I don't think that everybody needs a belt to get over. It's a beautiful prop to have in promo pictures and things, but I think you can be just as important with the belt and without the belt.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I was looking through like people you faced in the first couple of years as a tag team and singles, and it's pretty much a who's who of like Noob Dar, Demo, of course, and now yep. Killian Dane, Jackie Polo, Coffees. Did you find that even though they were still in like the young part of their career, however you want to put it, did you see something in them? Did they teach you something at the same time, or is every match a learning experience?
I think the biggest thing that you learn from all the guys like that is just how much they actually want it, and how you can take yourself seriously, but you should be taking the business seriously as well. All those guys have done absolutely amazing to get where they went, especially guys like, I'm especially Noam, because Noam's like really, really talented, but he's the smallest guy out of everybody you've just mentioned there, and he's done amazing to go with the Cruiserweight Classic, and then now he's a regular feature on NXT UK, and that's a guy that put in so much work to get where he needed to be. And I think that definitely being critical of myself as something that I've done far too long is take myself seriously, but not actually taking the business seriously, not taking it as a business, but taking it more as a hobby. And I think when you start thinking it as a hobby, you start thinking it can be picked up and dropped whenever you want. And realistically, that's not how I wanted to look at wrestling. So yeah, that's the biggest thing. All those guys got to where they wanted to be because A, they were good, and B, they were professional and wanted to get it.
So they put them both together and treated it as a business as opposed to just a thing to do. Right, so after Disco Biscuits, I could get my timelines incorrect here, but I've got you down as the Reaver at that point. Am I remembering rightly that it was Rabid Beaver was the combination of Reaver. I seem to remember that. It could have been an Alan Grogan thing on Clash of Titans that he was saying. But what was the thoughts behind the name, the Reaver?
Well, I just needed, I was looking to be more serious. Like, Mike wanted to turn me heel, and I thought, well, I can't be a dancing disco guy because nobody's going to take that serious. So I thought, well, I want to use my own name, my surname, which is Bryden. And the Taylor part is my dad's surname. My dad's adopted. So his surname before he was adopted was Taylor. So I took the Taylor and the Bryden and made it my name. And then when you actually Google where the Bryden name comes from, it comes from the borders in Roxburghshire. And once upon a time, there were highway bandits down there called the Reavers. So when you go down to the borders, there's pubs called the Reavers. They've got a rugby team called the Reavers. And it's basically just like a bandit. And also it was mildly inspired by Firefly, where the main villains are called the Reavers as well.
So Alan Grogan sold me a dud with that comment. Yeah. But speaking of Clash of Titans, you had a match against Martin Kirby, which... I would say around about this time, I can't remember if it was before or after, you had a match with Robbie Brookside, but I would say that's one of the more experienced guys you would have faced at that time. What was your thoughts going into that match, if you remember?
I was actually quite nervous. That show was meant to be sort of like a who's who, popular guys from WTL and SWA, and then there was a couple of imports in there, because I think Johnny Kidd was in there facing Damo. And then you had Fergal Devitt facing Joe Coffey as well. So there was a couple of names that had been brought in. And Martin Kirby was a name that was brought in for me to face. And at the time, do you remember the Wrestling Channel?
Oh, yeah.
It was, the Wrestling Channel was... I think it was just after the Wrestling Channel had finished. But Martin Kirby was one of those guys you'd seen a lot on that. So at the time, I thought, well, it's going to be quite good. I'm looking forward to facing him. And it really helped that he's actually just a really nice person as well. So it made it really easy to actually work with him when we were there. And it was sort of my first opportunity to work somebody that was a lot more experienced than me to actually try and learn something, which I really appreciate. It's something that I haven't done a massive amount. I think the lack of wrestling people that have made a name in wrestling has hindered my development slightly. I'm going to be 100% honest with that. To get better, you need to wrestle people that are better than you so that you can learn. And obviously getting the opportunity to wrestle Martin Kirby, Robbie Brookside, Johnny Kidd, guys like that were all great experiences. But I just wish that I was able to do that more to actually be able to grow better as a performer.
Yeah, and again, did you put that down to you just not 100% being in? So you weren't putting yourself out there to go to other places to get that experience?
I wouldn't even say by saying that I was waiting for them to come to me, it sounds a bit arrogant. I wasn't. I got in wrestling everything I deserved. Everything that I put in is exactly what I got. So I was never bitter. I was never annoyed at any stage that I wasn't getting anything, because I knew that what I was getting was what I deserved at that time. And so I'd be stupid to sit there and say I deserve more when I wasn't watching my diet, I wasn't learning and progressing in my training in terms of in the gym. I was going to wrestling training and I was getting fitter in the ring, I was getting better in the ring, but I wasn't investing in the entire product, investing in me as a person. So it was just one of those things that it was what it was, but you're right, I wasn't putting myself out there, I wasn't making a CV, I wasn't making an effort to try to go down south. And I think that was in part because I just didn't think that, I didn't think anybody's going to book somebody that was looking the way I did at the time, or that didn't have a fully fleshed out gimmick. So again, and it's just a learning experience, it's just something that I sat there with and I could have done more with and I didn't.
I mean, I think you started at an age where it can be a marathon, not a sprint. So you're picking up these bits of the puzzle as you go along. I've just mangled two analogies in that. But you're picking up these little pieces as you go along. My first experience of seeing Taylor Bryden, though, would have been 2012, which would have been the Elgin leg of whatever tour. It wasn't Wrestling Showdown at the time, but the W3L tour.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, I was weird because they put up all the matches last year from it. So I was like, oh, I'm definitely going to go and watch this. I totally forgot this match happened. And then I watched it with new eyes, and it was the best match on the show. It was yourself against CJ Hunter.
Oh, yeah. I remember that.
Yeah, it was so... I don't know if when I watched it at the time, because I was quite new to this whole landscape of Scottish wrestling, British wrestling, that I was there for the funny bits. I was there for you and being silly and all that kind of stuff. And although I hated inflatable hammers, I still do. Which I told Mike that, and I felt really bad for saying it to him directly. I hate them. I know why they're used, but I still think they're just awful. And you got the brunt of them, if I remember right.
Then that day.
Yeah,
we'd sold so many of them as well, and the kids absolutely hammered with them. And they're not sore if you're just getting hit a little bit, but when you've got like 10 kids around you, leathering hammers at you, they could get a bit stingy.
Oh, I watched kids turn it, and so they're hitting you with the claw end, and I thought, that's just psychopathic. That's just, yeah, why are they doing that? Anyway, so that's a bit of traveling then. So is there any particular memories or stories that are clean? Or that you can tell, that you remember of doing those kind of tours?
I used to love the Northern tour, because you would go up and it'd be 4 shows, 3 days, and you would just have a great laugh. Like, you would be in we used to stay in Inverness in one of the hostels, and we got an entire room to ourselves. So we would have like maybe 13, 14 of us in the one room, and it would just be just brilliant, good fun. Like, I was never one for going out. I'm not much of a drinker at all. So there'd be a selection that would go out for a couple of drinks. There'd be a selection that would go for takeaway food. And there'd be the rest of us that just kind of sat and just kind of chat rubbish. But yeah, it was always interesting. Actually, I think you've just said that you think the first time you seen me was in 2013, 2012?
2012, yeah.
I think you maybe seen me before that. Because I think I was the Bulgarian Baker the year before.
The 2012 was the first W3L show I went to. So that was only the second show ever. I didn't even know W3L came to Elgin at that point. So,
okay. So I must have been asked about that I was a baker.
I'm just starstruck because I love the baker. I don't know if you know that. I love the Bulgarian baker. It's ridiculous. I shouldn't enjoy it. Be the next year. Yeah, because the baker changes each year.
It does, yes.
Yes, depending on his particular diet of bread at that particular moment in time. I mean, I didn't mention it when you were saying you were Matsuo Kazuma, but what was it like working under a mask?
I actually quite like working under a mask, as long as the mask fits. Like, sometimes if you've got a mask that doesn't fit, it can cover your eyes and it becomes a nightmare to try and see. There was one time I was in Fraserburgh. I was doing a charity show for, what was his name? I can't remember. I was doing a charity show for a guy Jason Rotunda, that's it. Doing a charity show for Jason Rotunda, and I was wrestling, I think it was Martin Stallion, and he punched me square in the nose as I was wearing my mask, and there was just blood pouring everywhere, and I was wearing a mask at the time that had like mesh eye sockets, and the blood was just going into the mesh, and I just couldn't see a thing in that match. So it can be a nightmare, but as long as nobody punches in your nose, it's actually fine.
My favourite thing about Jason Rotunda, I never saw him wrestle because by the time I started watching, he was gone, it stopped. But I still remember going through Macduff, and there was a sign that said, train with former ECW star Jason Rotunda. And I saw it and I thought, I know a little bit about wrestling. I know Jason Arndt. He used to be Joey Abs. Is it him for some reason? And then I had a WWE Live. I used to get the DVDs, WWE Live DVDs, when they came to England and that. And I checked the back of the box and I was like, oh, he's against Vance Archer in 2 minutes. And even funnier, right about the same time, my dad had also seen, worked at the bins in Fraserburgh.
Yeah.
And he went, oh, there's a boy at my work. He said he used to do a bit of wrestling. Who? Oh, I think his name's Jason or something. "Oh right, this is weirdest. This is the weirdest thing ever." So
comes from Circle.
Yeah, exactly. So he's gone from wrestling Vance Archer to working on the bins of Fraserburgh. It's just a weird world is wrestling, a small world as well. Anyway, we kind of veered off topic with some road stories. So again, any memories, stories of shows up here or just traveling?
No, like not really. Like because all the shows kind of it's more just the times that you're with everybody. Hmm. Like there was one show that we did up in Wack that always makes me laugh. This was a little bit later on. We were in a six-man, and me and Divers were on the same team. And Divers had forgot his wrestling boots back at the hostel, so he had to wear his trainers and his kick pads. And Nathan Reynolds had power-bombed him, and his shoe had kind of buckled inside his kick pad, so it looked like he'd broke his ankle. Like, all of us were sitting staring at it like he'd broke his ankle, and it just turned out that his shoe had fell to the side, so his shoe fell off. And then Nathan had tagged Mike in, and Mike came to get him. So Divers was wrestling with one trainer on and one sock. And I'm in tears. Like, actually, was crying. I was so glad that my back was facing the crowd because I was crying with laughter. And Divers cuts off Mike and starts battering on his shoe at his head. Just keeps hitting Mike, and then he turns it around, he puts it on his nose, he's like, "Get it, smell, it's the good stuff." And all the while, he stands up and he tags me in, and I was like, "Oh, why are you tagging me in?" I'm crying, so I'm tears streaming, absolutely crying. I kick Mike once and tag out because I just can't be in the ring because I'm just laughing too much.
Oh, I could just imagine it. I know that, I mean, when the ones come up, a little bit further down my way anyway, there can be riots. Just some of the strangest things can happen. Perfect way to segue into that though. You found success later on in your career. 2017, I've got down here. 2016. 2016, you won the golden ticket ladder match, and you cashed it in on the tag team champions at the time, which were Games and Gains or Gains and Games. It was Jason Reed and Kevin Williams. And you end up forming a team with Dickie Divers as a contingency plan. Was there any thought that you put? Was you Divers kind of thought, well, could become a team? What was there any input for that?
It was more Mike. Like, that group had like a couple of different iterations before it eventually settled on me, Divers, and for a while James Scott was also part of the group as well, just because for different reasons. I think it was originally meant to be Mikey Whiplash that was in it, but then Mike changed it to BT Gunn, and then he changed it to James. So there was always meant to be a group of three people, and I think I hadn't been doing anything, and Divers wasn't doing anything, so I think he just thought, we'll just throw them all together and we'll actually have like a sort of heel unit that we can use in different parts of the show. Like, sometimes it was overdone. There was one, Seven Deadly Sins, that me and Divers were on, and I think out of the seven matches that night, me and Divers were involved in five of them. And by the time the end match came out and we wandered out, you could just see people were raging. It wasn't even good heat. People were just annoyed that we were there. And it was just, because we just practically just ruined the entire show by coming out in every single match.
And you end up actually feuding with Divers as well, which was kind of the same. You'd end up getting involved, because I don't know if we're speaking about the same one, but there was I think it was the Seven Deadly Sins that went up on YouTube, that it was, you'd end up costing each other moments of the whole show. One or the other would be involved in the other's matches. What was it like just that whole run? Because it seemed to be, you start shedding the Reaver name, and it was in that kind of transition point between that and your Tier Zero stuff. So did you find that was your kind of evolution, that downfall and feud with Divers?
Yeah, it was just good to do, because like, I get on really well with Divers, and it was just a good opportunity to work with them. And we always knew that that's how it was going to go, that we weren't going to be a long-term thing. I knew that, like, Mike was wanting to turn me face and he was always going to keep Diver's heel. Like, I think we'd sort of pitched potentially doing, like, me and Ewan versus Jack and Divers. Like, that was, like, sort of as it was coming to the end. But then, obviously, coronavirus has got in the way, sort of that. Because that had been something that we'd pitched that could have potentially happened, but it hadn't up to that point anyway. So, but yeah, I was good being able to work with him. And it was good being able to, like, win my first singles title off of Divers at Dunfermline when I beat him for the showdown belt. Like, it was a good experience to actually, even though I dropped it the very next night, it was good to be able to work as a, like, have some singles gold. Yeah. I just wish I got more than one promo photo where that was the mistake. I should have got multiple promo photos.
Oh, that's the key. I mean, even myself, who's got belts, I'd only one on eBay. Plenty of photos. You got to get them all in as when you can. So from that point, I mean, you started venturing out a bit more. You end up in Dundee a couple of times for your sins. Yep. You also end up in Fair City Wrestling.
Yes.
Their debut show, if I remember rightly. I think you've been on.
No, I wasn't at their debut show. I was at the next two shows after that. So they ran their first show, which I think that night I was working at W3L. I think they were on the same night. I'm pretty certain they were on the same night. I might be wrong. But yeah. So I ended up on the second show tagging with Tommy Cross against Omar Muhammad and John Alpha. And then the next one was Lewis Gervin versus me versus Luke.
Of course, I do remember that. I remember that second one particularly because it was just everyone was kicking each other pretty much. It was quite a hard-hitting match. So that's kind of a place that you're kind of trying to sink your teeth into outside of WDL. Definitely. What was it like going in front of a non-W3L crowd? I mean, it's not something you would have done too often, being kind of W3L mainstay. What was it like going in front of a new crowd?
Good. Like, a crowd, like, even when you're in W3L, it's not like you go out expecting anyone to actually know you anyway. Like, you do get your regulars that do come to shows. Like, there are people that you'll see year in, year out, but you don't go out expecting them to know you anyway, so you just treat it the same. Just treat it like that you've got to prove yourself and show everybody who you are in that moment, because, like, there's a good chance that 80% of the audience, if not closer to 95%, don't know who you are. Maybe recognise you for the poster and that's it.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose outside of those, I mean, W3L itself, they don't really run stories as much. No. They have a couple that run through tours or run through their wrestling showdown footage. But generally, they're kind of like one shots and your stories that show. Usually it's bad guy, good guy, then bad guy, good guy. Bad guy from the first one comes in at the end, tag team match at the end. Which I was so cocky when I realised that was the formula. And then the year after that, Mike changed it entirely. And I was like, it's cottoned on. It's cottoned on, yeah. That I've noticed.
To be fair, he uses that formula up north. Like, just because it's a smaller team that runs, like, on the tours down south, like Leeds and things that we do, and then the northern tour. I think he does more sort of like a storyline focused one, like sort of focused events in Fife and Edinburgh. But yeah, like, totally. The ones up north have definitely got a formula.
Yeah, so as soon as I noticed it, the year after, there was like guys from, there was like Aspen Faith and that tour around about Aberdeen area, so they could come through, and there was a bit more of a storyline. There's still the Baker though, which I'm more than happy about.
There's always a Baker.
I'll take the usual formula if I'm getting the Bulgaria Baker somewhere in there. As the Baker, as I finish up speaking about him, did you go through a character? Were your thoughts? Are you gonna put? Did you put? I can't remember. Did you put an accent, or was there any particular thoughts going in as the Bulgarian Baker?
Not really. It was more like, I'm the Baker this year. So you just kind of have to go with it. And the year that I was the Baker, we had a clown mask. So I was instead a creepy clown baker that year. And I made multiple children cry because children are scared of clowns, and clown bakers apparently frighten them even more. So, yeah, that was it, really. Nothing really different. I didn't really go for comedy that year. I just went for scary because all the kids were scared of the mask anyway, so I just kind of leant hard into that.
I now remember that clown. That's the one that's been, I think, got more pictures as the Bulgarian baker in that mask than you do with the Wrestling Showdown title. Because I know there's a good few about that mask.
There is one photo movie with the Showdown belt, and I think there's a good five or six. Because in the match with, I think it was Livewire at the time, his nose got broken. No, it wasn't broken. It was just his nose was bloody. And because I was wearing the white baker uniform, it was stained in his blood. And then the next year, because we thought the blood looked so effective, we bought a new one and we just stained it with like fake blood instead.
Yeah, this is all coming back to me in all its bakery glory.
That was my year as a baker. I just modelled my baker on the Great Muta and was just walking beautifully around the ring.
I think that's a comparison that may only ever be said on this podcast. The Bulgarian baker and the Great Muta. So before we move on to, I guess, your transformation last year, any memories with the Tormentor? He seems to be a big favourite in W3L.
He's a massive favourite. I think he should be a massive favourite in just Scottish wrestling in general, because he's just such a lovable person. He's a good guy, but I'm really looking forward to seeing what the Tormentor does out of his mask and with just his normal face, just out as a baby face.
I'm still putting my money on wanting to see the Tormentor against that Roderick Jones.
It might happen one day. And then maybe. You've got Roderick Jones' brother, Jamie Jones, refereeing at the same time.
There you go. And I'm sure the baker will be hanging about. There's a glint in his eye last time I saw him. That give me the tip off that he may be a tormented soul. Right. So the last year or so, you've went from not having the ripped physique to suddenly these pictures turned up on the interweb. You put them up, obviously, not some sort of creepy leak thing, but of you looking, to steal a phrase from Looking Sharp, ripped and jacked. Talk about how you transformed yourself.
It's not really a transformation. It was just I'd always been to the gym and I'd always been training, but I just sort of focused the shift in my training and, more importantly, like focused a shift for looking at training to nutrition, because I was always under that impression that you could always out train a bad diet, and I just simply came to the realization that you can't, and I really, really just wanted to shift some body fat and hopefully just look a bit better in spandex. That was my original goal, so I went and suck out the help of a guy called Neil In versus Out Nutrition, and what he done for me is he set forward sort of calorie goals and a calorie deficit, and I just stuck to that. And within the first 4 months of doing it, I'd lost 25 pounds. I'd lost 25 pounds in 4 months, and then we went on to like a maintenance phase, so I was 175 pounds, but in my maintenance phase, I was still eating more calories, but I was still burning off enough that I lost another 20 pounds after that. So I ended up sitting at 156 pounds at my lowest, and that was from at the start of last year when I was 211. So I'd managed to lose a fair amount of body weight, and in that time I'd also managed to put on a good amount of muscle mass as well and lose body fat. So my goal for last year was to get down to about 17% body fat, and by Christmas Eve, when I got a 3D body scan, I was 12.5%. So I was dead happy with how my year went.
Wow! I mean, you've certainly made use of lockdown and not being able to go anywhere by just I think I put on what you lost during lockdown and during that time. So was there anything else that kept you occupied during this lockdown? We're still in it, kind of. During that time, or was it just kind of just working on yourself and improve yourself mentally and physically?
Yeah, I didn't want to get into like a sort of state where I was staying up really late and then getting up late in the morning. I'm quite an early bird. I like to get up at like sort of about 7 most mornings anyway, but I didn't want to lose sort of routine having no work at the time. I was quite scared that I would kind of not stick to my boundaries about that. So I sat and wrote down like a little itinerary for my day, and I would just make sure that I was training in the morning, I was going for a walk in the afternoon to get my steps up, and then I'd set time aside to actually not just watch wrestling, actually do some tape study, take notes, and like look out different people to watch and get some inspiration for when wrestling eventually came back. Me thinking it was going to be summer last year, but ended up still not happened yet. So that's just what I've been doing, just like tape study. I bought a couple of books on pro wrestling, Mike Quackenbush's book on how to become a pro wrestler. Like, it's a really good training tool, even if the guy that wrote it's a bit of a door handle.
Perfect way to put it. So, yeah. I was thinking what you were going to say, but yeah, door handle, we'll go for that.
Yeah. So yeah, that's kind of been my year, just trying to improve, get better, get faster, get stronger, get smarter, get ready. Completely ready, ready to be wrestling again.
It's scary to think. I was looking at just at the site, and as of recording, the Sunday just coming was the last show with the crowd in Scotland, last wrestling show. And at that point, we were thinking, it'll be 2.5 weeks. That's it. We'll be fine. We're all good to go again. And here we are a year later. I mean, I'm quite enjoying it because I started the podcast because of it, but I know that a lot of people are finding it a bit more difficult because of things like unable to work and not having that routine like you've got. I mean, this is my office, my bedroom's there. So that is my whole commute now. It's just going to the next room. So tier zero then, but we'll get to, what was the inspiration behind that character and name?
Well, I really like playing card games. Like, there's a card game called Keyforge that I really enjoy, and I also really enjoy Yu-Gi-Oh!, like the trading card game as well. And I suppose in every card game, there's always like a top meta, like the most effective tactic available. And usually you get decks that are separated into tiers. Like you get your tier 4 decks that are usually rubbish, tier 3, tier 2, tier 1, and then the best decks, the ones that win the most tournaments, are always tier 0 decks. And the same can be said like in Street Fighter, Super Smash Bros, you've got characters that are tier 0 characters that the most competitive players in the world play as, because they're the ones that have got the most different strategies that they can be used for winning. And I thought, well, I already play these games and I sort of understand the meaning behind them. So I thought, well, I'd make a good character. So it's nothing based on the fact that Nicola Sturgeon put Scotland into tiers. I was tier 0 before we were.
I didn't know it was based on card games. I think I thought it was more like a Matrix video game sort of thing, but no, I didn't know it was into the card games. I mean, I know there seems to be a lot. I think Omar Mohammed, probably Jetstream Jack around about Scottish wrestling, are big into Yu-Gi-Oh! I like Pokemon for a bit. The cards, and then they got banned from school, and then I kind of lost interest from that point because they always got banned from schools. So I'd be remiss if I don't ask, favourite Yu-Gi-Oh card?
Favourite Yu-Gi-Oh. See, I play a deck that's not very popular. It's called Counter Fairies. It's useless, but I really enjoy it because it's, you get to set traps for people to fall into. So it's a really good strategic deck. So I'm going to go with Air Knight Parshanth.
I don't know what that is, but I will take your word for it.
Don't have to know.
If it's not one of the dragons, blue-eyed, red-eyed, I don't know, black-eyed, I'm kind of lost with Yu-Gi-Oh! Entirely.
Yeah, fair enough.
So speaking of Omar, though, he's put in a couple of questions. He put, ask him about that delayed suplex.
Yeah. So I was wrestling Omar at a sort of charity gala gig. We were doing like a show to raise funds for a town's gala. So they paid us to come in and do it. And I was wrestling Omar on that show. Now, as you know, Omar doesn't have the best track record with having clothing that fits him when he's wrestling. Oh, he's wrestling boots that one time. And he'd got new wrestling tights that either didn't have a drawstring in them or he hadn't tied his drawstring. So I'd picked him up for a delayed suplex and I had a hold of his tights and his tights started slipping up and up and up. And as his little legs are in the air, he could feel that something was maybe going to fall out. So his little legs were doing this. Just desperate for me to drop him so that he didn't end up flashing the entire crowd.
Yes, you probably have heard my rants about, I only had one rant in writing about his shoe choices. Oh God, I'm so glad he asked about that then. I also asked, my first time floor pressing.
Oh yeah. So me and Omar train at the same gym and often like we'll go to the gym together and I showed him how to floor press, which is just a bench press, but you're sitting on the floor. And I put too much weight on the bar for him, so when he picked it up, he immediately dropped it on his face. And because it was stuck in this position, it was too heavy, he couldn't get it off. So he was just lying on the floor with a bar, like luckily not choking him, but in a place where he couldn't turn his head to get out of it. So I said to him, are you okay? He said yes. So I took a picture of it because it was too funny not to.
I would love to, for both incidents, I would love to be the fly on the wall for that, because that just, so does he try and avoid hanging out with you now, just in case something goes wrong?
You know what, it actually seems like that, because anytime I ask him to come to the gym, it always happens to be busy, so yeah, I think I've scarred him for life.
I mean, you only did what you had to do, was take a picture. If it was their way around, I'm sure he would have done the exact same to you.
Oh, I expect him. I also took a picture of him when he did a squat and his trousers ripped from his waistband right through to his gusset. I just thought it was too funny.
Yeah, I can see why he doesn't hang out with you anymore. So you said you've been spending your time other than just losing weight. You've also been. That sounded really bad when I said that out loud, but it's in the context of what we've already discussed.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah. Just for anyone listening that skips and that just says that. You said you'd be watching tapes and be more focused. Is there any particular wrestlers that you've been trying to watch specifically or any promotions specifically you've been watching?
Not specific promotions, but definitely sort of like a specific style. Like I'm wanting to sort of move to a more sports-based presentation, like something that looks a little bit more legitimate, because I'm athletic, but I'm not like the most athletic guy. Like I can't do double springboard moonsaults, like that's not my style, and there will be guys on shows that can do that, and if I can't do it better, then I'm not going to do it. So I want it to move to more sort of a wrestling based style, sort of catch wrestling. So I've been watching a lot of Tyson Dukes' stuff, which has been awesome. It's been a godsend over lockdown, because he's been doing a lot of sort of training and structural stuff, even things about psychology on being a mat wrestler. So yeah, been watching a lot of him. Jonathan Gresham has been another person that I've been watching. Drew Gulak, and just a lot of Japanese stuff as well, because even though a lot of Japanese wrestling's a lot of strike based stuff and big moves, you do get the odd match that it's got really good sort of technical stuff, like Yohei from Noah, one of their junior heavyweights. He's been brilliant for watching and things like that as well.
I mean, speaking of the people that you mentioned, I watched some of Tyson Dukes' stuff, and I remember when he was in TNA briefly, like the Super X
Team Canada.
Yes, yeah, I remember that. From the Wrestling Channel, from the day. His stuff, so it seems so simple. Things like raising yourself when I don't know what the move is, but when you drop down and the guy runs over, you know, that kind of stuff, and he just lifts his body slightly, so it trips the guy. So yeah,
that's what that move is. Like a lot of people, you'll see them do it. You get the headlock, shot off, shoulder tackle, and then the guy goes for the sort of drop down or the sleep, if you want to call it that, and the guy jumps straight over him. It's very rare that that move actually does what it intends to do, and that's to trip the guy up. So it's actually one of those things that it's clever. Like, it's really clever because nobody does it. Like, I think me and Yoon, for a while, we used to use a double team move where we'd double whip the guy into the corner. He would feed out and I'd whip Yoon. Yoon would run and do the sweep to take his legs from him. So we used to do something similar to that. But in the context of, like, catch wrestling stuff, it makes sense because you could use it to transition to your next thing. It doesn't just need to be a throwaway, right, quick jump over me, we've got this next thing to do. It can be something that you can make more of.
Yeah, so like, because it's much like things like DDT and super kick, stuff like that. The more it's done, the less impact it has. So
definitely,
when you see something like that. And just the simple things like using the ropes to sell and just little pieces of just, like I say, when you watch it, you think, why isn't everyone doing this? But it's because it's so phased out that now it's coming back and it's making things all better. Are you keeping track of things like WWE and AEW, stuff like that?
Oh yeah, I keep track of everything. Like I don't have enough time to watch every single piece of television that they produce, but I always keep up to date with what's happening, and I'll always go back and watch something that's been reported as good. But yeah, like AEW's been pretty good recently. Like, their stuff on television's been brilliant. A lot of the good matches on it.
Yeah, I don't know. Something about AEW I just can't get into. I don't know if it's like they're trying too hard in some ways, and then not trying hard enough in other ways. It's strange, but I'm still. WWE just seems to always grab me back in their bloody Thunderdome, which I still seem to be dragged into each month. Thoughts on that kind of thing? If wrestling was to come back, but you can't wrestle in front of anyone, and Mike just decides to tape Wrestling Showdown, would that be something you'd be for, or do you prefer to have a bit of a crowd, a bit of an atmosphere?
I think I could do either. I think it's good to have the atmosphere, but if there's a choice between wrestling with no one and it being filmed to be distributed on the internet and no wrestling, I think I would choose, like, wrestling in front of the cameras. Like, at this point, it's been so long that I would just take any kind of action, like, to be wrestling.
Yeah. When this all started, I know there's a lot of wrestlers at the moment that are just like, I can't watch it with no crowd, but I think even now, a year in, even they're starting to think, oh, I mean, if I can wrestle, then maybe I'll do it in front of nobody. So, as I said, as far as watching, you'd be studying that. Who would you say your favourites are now? I'm assuming Jericho's still hanging around there.
Yeah, Jericho's always been great. Like, the Madonna of wrestling, kind of constantly reinventing himself to stay relevant. Like, there's never been a guy in wrestling that's done so much. Like, I know, like, you've got your Terry Funks that went from, like, a main event guy in the NWA era to a hardcore icon in later years, but nobody's reinvented themselves more than Jericho. Currently in wrestling, a lot of the guys that I've just said, like I've been watching like a lot of Tyson Dukes' stuff, Johnny Gargano, like really good, Tommaso Ciampa, like as more sort of going back and watching like old takeovers and things and realising how great NXT has been. It's so consistently good since its inception. Like, there's been so many good people in that promotion doing such great matches and doing such great stuff. Like, a lot of the storylines in NXT have just been so simple but so effective. It's like wrestling 101. And yeah, just been enjoying watching that sort of stuff.
Oh, I like to say when wrestling's done right, it looks easy. And yeah NXT's totally pretty good at that.
They never overbook anything. Like, or it never seems overbooked. Like, I know that they did a little bit that seemed a little bit convoluted with Johnny Gargano and Tommaso Ciampa for a while, but I think that was necessitated out of injury rather than anything. But like the actual, usually it's just like paint by numbers wrestling, like just really good simple stuff that works.
Absolutely. And as far as goals, wild goals, who would be your dream match?
Like if we're talking about like dream matches, if I could face absolutely anybody, like yeah, it would be Shawn Michaels. Like if I'm going like all time, like definitely Shawn Michaels or Eddie Guerrero, because both of them are both fantastic in different ways, and you would just learn so much by actually working with the guys. If you're talking about like in Britain, I would probably say that I would love to wrestle Joe Coffey again and Noam Dar again, because I would like to actually test myself and be able to do better than I did the first time, be able to actually have more input into it and be able to like feel more proud of what I've left in the ring than I've previously experienced. I suppose to right wrongs in my own mind that I didn't do so well the first time, so I'd like to go back and do it again.
And it's handy that they're in NXT UK as well, so I mean that could be another overarching goal. But is there any particular promotions you want to get to, whether it's Europe, America, UK?
I'm not going to set my goals too lofty. I do definitely want to work more places in the UK. That's on the hit list for this year. It's something that I'm going to put a lot of energy in and a lot of effort into doing, is getting together a decent CV with really good promo shots and attempting to sort of edit our promo package together and be able to try and work elsewhere down south. Like, I would really enjoy working down south. And if I can, I would love to work somewhere in Europe, like, just to be able to say that I've done it and try and make connections and see where I can go from there. In terms of Scotland, I would love to keep doing my work for W3L. I would love to work for Discovery. If that opportunity ever came, then it'd be something I'd be really interested in doing. Same with progressing FCW. I would love to be able to represent the junior heavyweight division at somewhere that I can see me fitting into. And I think probably if I can, I would love to be able to work at Reckless Intent as well as ICW, if that's an opportunity to do it. It's something that I'm going to have to work towards. It's something that I'm going to have to put an lot of graft to do, but I think that I've got the tools and the ability to push on and get somewhere this year. I want to be able to get somewhere in wrestling that I can be proud of.
I don't know why, but as soon as you started mentioning things like Discovery, my first thought was Reckless would be a really good place as well. Just because they kind of have a bit close ties, but they have guys like that. Again, Tier Zero, we know it's about the cards, but they've got guys like Jetstream Jack, and they've got guys like Alex Webb. So they've got a little bit of a different style, but their kind of characters kind of mesh well, and it could be something interesting with like promos and things like that. And also, I'm noticing you're using your social media a bit more now.
Yes, I'm making a concerted effort. If I'd known what I know about social media now, back in 2008, I would have had a Bebo page dedicated to Taylor Bryden. But it was not one of those things. It's something that nobody really did back then. And the people that were really good on social media have ended up being people that have done really well in wrestling, because you need to be really good at promoting yourself, and it's something that I've never been great at. You need to be good at promos as well, and that's something that this year I'm making a concerted effort to actually try and get better at. And not even, like, it's not like I've ever not practiced promos, but I want to have the opportunity on shows to actually speak in front of live crowds and things, because you can practice in your mirror with facial expressions as much as you want. It's still not the same as being able to go out and actually speak to a live crowd and be able to feel the reactions from them and adjust your promo according to what they're reacting.
Well, I know from my very, very limited experience, promos in the mirror is easy until you get a microphone and you have to remember how you have to hold it to your face and you can't move it away. Oh God, I've had one nightmare doing that, where I was supposed to do a promo and I wasn't told beforehand, and I was like, right, you're going to do 1 minute promo, and that's it. Okay, cool. So I had the microphone here. I hopefully screenshots it to make it look dodgy, but I had it here, and nobody could hear a thing I said because it was going that way. And the second time I did it, I got to be heel, so it was great. I just called everyone smelly. Perfect. But we'll get to your social media in a bit so everyone can find out where you are. But it seems to me nowadays that the times have changed where you can't just send an email to someone and that's it. You've got to have a CV, you've got to have a Google Drive, you've got to have a promo package, pictures, music, and all that kind of thing. It's great that this advent of having no shows is getting everyone now to a level where they do Zoom and they can learn all these little skills, which hopefully means once shows are ready to go, everyone's ready to go. So before we get to your social media, I've got our two really stupid questions that we ask, which Omar didn't get the second question because it's quite new. But the first one is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
I'm going to go with a very basic answer and say Tyrannosaurus Rex.
That's a classic, but you can thank Kevin Williams for that question. And the other one is fairly new. What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow.
Do you have a reason for that?
I feel that the sheep are probably smaller than the cow and they're going to struggle to get any sort of offense in.
What I love about this question in particular is it's fairly split right now. But the ones that say sheep are really impassioned that it's going to be sheep. Because I think cow is the general, it's bigger, it's going to win in a fight. But for those that pick sheep, like myself, are just like, no, it's definitely sheep. And here's why. And here's a big list of reasons for a stupid question. I think we've just about covered your 16 years in pro wrestling. But hopefully we've covered it enough for folk to go, they want to see more of Taylor Bryden. Yep. But
where can people find you on social media? You can find me at Taylor Bryden Pro Wrestler on YouTube. You can also find me at Taylor Bryden on Facebook. And I think my handle is Tier Zero on Instagram and potentially Twitter as well.
It's Tier Zero TB, but the zero TB. is the actual zero.
Yes, so which is something that I'm terrible at. I will be getting promo pictures with those social media handles on to try and sell at shows so that people can see my things and they'll be able to follow me. Hopefully, that's the plan. Fingers crossed.
Well, I'll tag you in loads of stuff before this episode comes out anyway, so everyone will definitely know where you are. But again, thank you very much for joining me today.
Perfect. Thanks for asking me to do this, Billy. It's been a good experience. It's something that I don't get a chance to do very much, is talk about my time in wrestling, and I've enjoyed it.
So, well, next time I speak to you, hopefully wrestling's back and you've had a couple more shots with that at the title belt. And
perfect.
We'll be able to get that in there. But great, thank you again.
No, well, perfect. Thanks very much. Take care. Bye.